Guys, so we are live from the Shaw Strength and Evolution Athletic store. You can see the bins behind me. And apparently, I'm doing a question answer with Queen Elizabeth.
Hi, hello, Queen. Everybody.
Well, hello, Queen Elizabeth.
Hello, how are you?
You kind of sound like a sick cat, is what you sound like.
Yes, I am very sick, and I'm a cat.
Okay. Oh, there he is. There he is. Mr. Edward Hall.
I mean, it took me a donkey age to work out how this camera works, but are you all good?
Yeah, we're good. You look really good, except your head is massive.
Oh, I know. I was born with this massive head.
Yeah.
And you, how can you talk about massive heads? We've had this conversation. We've had the tape measure out.
Yeah.
And we know your head is bigger than mine, so shut up, okay?
I feel like you forgot that very quickly, that your head was actually bigger. Oberst, to be fair, Oberst's head is like way bigger than either one of our heads.
Oh, so. Oberst's head is like, Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
It's literally like a hot air balloon. Oberst's head is like, you can literally cut his head off, put a bit of hot air in it, and it would just float up, and you'd be like, there's a massive hot air balloon.
Yeah.
That's how big Oberst's head. Yeah.
So we're both safe, is the good news. Yeah.
Yeah, that for sure.
How's the staying at home? How's that all working out for you, man?
It's actually really nice for me. I mean, I'm the same as you, Brian. I've been on the road for every day for months and months and months. And then when I was actually in Australia doing a bit of a tour of Australia when all this kicked off, and I had to get an emergency flight home. That literally had to remortgage my house to do that.
That's ridiculous.
But honestly, like, I'm having the time of my life. I know that's a horrible thing to say, and obviously the circumstances, but
sure.
It's so nice being at home for once. And I can't do anything but train and do DIY. I just bought a new house, so I'm just decorating and doing stuff like that. So it's nice, mate. It's actually a real nice change for me.
Yeah, I think it's been a good change of pace for me, too. I mean, it's something where, like Eddie said, we're, you know, both of us are on the road. We're, you know, it's like different appearance or different event or whatever going on. So it's actually nice to stay home, spend the time with the family a little bit and be able to get some projects and things done at home. But I'm ready for it to go back to normal. I'm not going to lie. It's going to get old really quickly, as I'm sure it has for a lot of people, you know?
Yeah. Oh yeah, definitely.
Well, you ready for these questions?
Yeah. Yeah. Fire away, buddy. Okay, are these from the public then? Is this from a post you put out?
This is from a post, yeah. So I just went through and tried to pick some. You know, try not to screw up if you can.
Okay, do my best.
Okay, thank you, yeah. If you had to share a bunk bed with Eddie, who would be top bunk?
Oh, 100% I would be top bunk. There's no way on this planet I would sleep below you in a bunk bed. That is literally suicide. That's pure suicide.
I would have to agree with you and say that I would take the bottom bunk. Although you above me would be disturbing, I do think that would be the safer scenario.
You do know that if that didn't actually happen and I got top bunk, I would like I would purposely jump up and down on the bed just so it collapsed onto you.
I have no doubt whatsoever that would happen all night and I wouldn't sleep. And it would be horrible. It would be absolutely horrible. Yeah.
Yeah.
It sounds like a nightmare situation being in the same room with you, let alone a bunk bed.
Now, come on.
Okay. When you were competing at World's Strongest Man, were you and Eddie friends or just pure competition?
No. Don't we answer this?
Why don't you go for it? Yeah, go for it.
Okay, so I met you very first time, World's Strongest Man. 2012, Los Angeles.
Yeah, 2012. Do you remember the shorts that you were wearing during a lot of that competition?
Yeah.
Like how tiny they were?
Yeah.
I was.
Hey, I looked amazing, though.
I was embarrassed for you. go ahead, though. I just needed to throw
anyway,
that in.
Anyway, I think it's safe to say we weren't friends in 2012.
I just judged you a little bit on your shorts. That's all. I didn't dislike you. You know.
Well, I judged you on the size of your head. So
hey, fair enough. Fair enough.
And then 2013, I think we spoke and hung out a little bit. 14 the same. I think 2015 Malaysia is when we started hanging around a bit more, going out for food together in between events. And then 16 was the same. 17 was actually the year I won. Was actually the, I'd say the year me and you actually got the closest is in terms of friends.
Yeah.
We hired a truck. We went to have steak every single night, the same restaurant. We went out breakfast there, lunch there. Me and you traveled all over different parts of Africa together in between the events. I would say we helped each other out quite a lot.
Yeah.
World's Strongest Man 2016 and 17, which when you think about it is quite surreal, quite weird, because we are so competitive,
yeah,
so sort of alpha in our own domain, and yet we became good friends. And it's like, it's weird how it happened, really. And 17 was the top it all off for me, because I say, like, me and you were fierce competitors, but yet, I remember the night before the final, me and you went out to steak dinner together, and we got on so well. And I remember thinking to myself whilst you were in the restaurant, I was like, you're a cool guy. You're a cool guy for doing that. Hope you think the same back.
I do, yeah. I'll echo all of that, what Eddie just said, and, you know, it's something where, even though both of us are super competitive, you know, there's different things that we did at World's Strongest Man behind the scenes that'll never show up in any World's Strongest Man competition or anything. Honestly, that's, I think a lot of times the real story, you know, as the guys, I mean, there's a story that not a lot of people know. We were at World's Strongest Man in Botswana. You remember this, Ed, with the beds and the mattresses.
With the what?
With the mattresses in our hotel.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you went to buy beds.
Yeah, so we literally went together to a bed shop because the mattresses were awful, and we both were sleeping very bad. So we went and bought mattresses together, brought them, walked right in the front of the hotel with the mattresses together, and threw the other ones out in the hallway and said, well, we'll have new beds and sleep better. But, you know, it's something we did together. That's just one story, but like Ed said, we went and had meals and did different things. So even though we're both so competitive, it's something where, you know, we both have a switch that you can turn on. And when it was when it's competition time and the whistle blows, we're trying to beat each other at everything. But after we're done competing, you know, it's easy to shake hands and say, hey, good job, one way or the other, and then go out and have a meal. So it's a good question, though. Yeah. It is. I think a lot of people don't understand that, you know, there is that camaraderie at World's Strongest Man that it doesn't happen with everybody. I'm not going to say every competitor is that way, but for us, that was the way that it was.
Yeah. Well, I remember 2016, we went to a curry house the day you won, you won.
Yeah.
And then 2017, we went to a steakhouse the year I won.
Yeah, for sure.
So, we both went out to celebrate our wins against each other.
Yeah, it was good memories, for sure, good memories.
It was nice.
Yeah. Who is the better dancer?
Oh, that's me, all day long.
Have you ever seen a video of yourself dancing?
Yes, I have.
And
it was terrible.
Yeah.
But I'd still be a better dancer than you. I can imagine you dance like Baloo off Jungle Book.
Yeah, yeah.
And you look like him as well.
Well, thank you. That's nice of you to say that. Yeah. And from what I remember of Jungle Book, he was a pretty good dancer, so I'll take that. Because I feel like his dancing would beat yours any day of the week. So
yeah, he was actually, now I've said it.
How much money would you need to be paid to have Eddie Hall move in next door to you and start a reality TV show together?
Well, I think I can answer that for you, Brian. I think you do it for free. And I actually think you should pay them for me to move next door to you, mate.
Is that right?
Yeah.
You think that? Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I would have to say that would take a lot of money. Because I would not want to be Eddie's neighbor. I feel like I can guess pretty clearly what kind of neighbor he would be to me.
And, an amazing neighbor.
Amazing.
I would chuck my cat shit over to, like, help your plants grow.
Okay.
I would feed your dog nice things.
Would you?
I would, yeah. Okay. I would, don't really know, but I'd be a nice neighbor.
Yeah.
And we could train together.
The training would be the fun part. The waking up to your cat feces all over my yard would not be so fun. And I feel like you would do that on a regular basis. Yeah.
And you know I'd buy a rooster and put it as close to your fence as possible.
Yeah. I feel like you would just constantly think of things to do, you know?
100%. Yeah. 100%. Yeah.
So I wouldn't want him living next to me. That answers that question. Who has the bigger bench at the moment? Cheers from Croatia. The bigger bench at the moment.
I don't know. What are you benching right now, Brian?
I haven't hit a max yet, right? So I'm working up to a max, but, you know, I'm throwing up some decent numbers.
I would say my max right now would be six plates a side. So 260 would be like my absolute max right now.
Is that paused or not paused?
I can't do it any other way. That'd be paused.
Paused. Okay. I feel like I would have to say I feel like we're pretty even. I mean, I haven't hit that yet, but I will.
Okay.
And as soon as all this nonsense is over, you're going to come over and you're going to train with me, and we're going to do some bench and we'll find out.
Well, I mean, if I don't train bench from now to like, when I come to yours, maybe like 6 months a year,
you
might stand a chance of like keeping up.
Okay, well, good luck with that.
Okay.
We'll find out. I'm not going to say you're not a good presser, because you are a good presser, but you know, your arrogance might catch up to you.
It's fine. I bathe in my arrogance. It's fine.
Oh man, how do you guys like to peak for a show or big lift? What are the last few weeks of training like, and how do you rest up leading up to a comp?
You take that one, Brian.
All right. So basically, for me, and we'll try to break this down. Peak for a show or big lift. So coming in, what you want to do is you want to try to save your biggest lifts for the actual competition. And, you know, the training is to get strong for the competition or for the lift. And then, you know, you don't want to do all of it in the gym. Like, you don't want to set your personal best in the gym. And that's what I would say. So, number one, make sure you're healthy. Make sure you're being smart with your training. But typically for me, about 2 weeks out from a contest is when I start to kind of taper down, back off, so that at 2 weeks, I'm 100% fresh and ready to go into a competition. And basically the last few weeks, like I said, once I hit that kind of training peak at 2 weeks out, then I start to taper everything back.
Yeah, pretty much the same here.
Nothing to add to that?
No, not at all. As you say, I think 2 weeks before, I'll probably train at most sort of 75-80% to my max. And then the 2 weeks leading up to the comp will just be, I would say, just keep the muscles firing is the way to I'd go about it. So just doing little bits, fast, you know, fast twitch fibers, just keep things firing. But I wouldn't strain myself during that 2 week window.
Yeah. You got to save it for the competition. That's the best way to think about it.
Mm.
My question is for both of you. If, and that's a big if, somehow Thor fails that lift after everything that has happened in recent weeks, what effects do you think that would have on his career and the sport itself, if any?
Well, if he failed it.
Yeah, so he's saying it's if he failed the lift, and it's a big if. Because, you know, and what I will say to start off with is I think that that's a big point that a lot of people are forgetting about right now is everybody's just acting like this 501 kilo deadlift is a foregone conclusion. And then it's just when or if he wants to do it. If he does it in training or he does it in an actual contest, it's like it's already done. And I don't think it's already done. You know, it's you can't just sit here and say that that's a foregone conclusion. So I don't know if it is a big if. You know, I'm not saying that he's not capable of doing it. That's I don't want to go on record saying that. But at the same time, he has to do it. First and foremost, he has to do it. So what do you think? Let's go into the second part is if he did fail, what effect do you think that would have on his career and the sport itself, if any?
Well, I mean, as you say, he's not done it yet. And from what I can say this, from what I judge, from what I'm seeing from Force Training, I think he's close. And it's like, it is literally in my head, it's like 60-40, he's not going to do it.
Okay.
It's like 40% chance in my head he's going to do it. It's, I think he's a little bit behind of what I was when I was training for the 500. But you know what? Again, it's like, what can you pull out on the day? So we don't know. That's a question mark. It's not a big if. It's for the general public, it should be a 50-50 decision, really.
Sure.
Whether he's going to pull this or not. What will it do for the sport? I mean, nothing, really. I mean, I could have come back after I did 500 and did 501, 502, 503, 504, kept going up to 510. But what would be the point? You know, I could have gone on God knows to what, but what would be the point? I think the only thing it will do, really, I mean, if he fails it, it'll just destroy him as a person. It'll get in his head. He'll, you know, like, it's like, I know people that have trained their whole lives for competitions for World's Strongest Man and whatever else, and they never succeed. And that is soul destroying, you know, really soul destroying. It can, you know, if he's been saying he's going to do this for 4 years now, you know, and then all this build up to this, I just think it's going to hurt him mentally, right? He's going to have really thick skin if he does fail this lift, especially after all that's been said and done.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, it's the hype that's been built up around this lift is, you know, if he were to fail, which again, you know, there's so many factors to a lift that big to pull it off. It's not a foregone conclusion, but if he were to fail, I think it would have a big impact on him personally, just because of all the talking that's gone on. You know, I think it'd be really challenging, and you know, it's something where I think he would need to try to come back and redeem himself. I think he's just put so much pressure on himself now to make it happen. And you know, we'll just have to see. I mean, as far as the sport itself, I think the you know, I don't know that it'll affect the sport one way or the other, because it's technically not a competition, you know, and you know, the publicity could, you know, maybe in a way could be good, you know, but at the same time it also could be bad, because we don't want strongmen kind of opening up to all these different federations. And you know, again, I hope that it doesn't take the sport in the wrong direction either. You know, I want it to be good. And it's a tricky question to ask. I mean, I don't know what's going to happen, but at the same time, I think we will just have to sit back and see what happens, you know. During this quarantine, have you found it refreshing to be able to spend time with your family more than you normally would have with your busy schedules before?
I mean, for me, it has definitely been refreshing. I mean, since I won the World's Strongest Man, so the lead up to World's Strongest Man, I was obsessed. So it would be training, I'd eat, sleep, and shit strongman. And then when I won the World's Strongest Man, it was obsessed of sort of capitalizing on the win and building on the legacy. So I would say, I mean, last year, I mean, you know this, Brian, last year, I think out of the 365 days, I was literally on the road for 350 of them. Yeah. And that's no exaggeration. I was at home 15 days last year. And I would say those 15 days were spent doing, you know, doing the washing, repacking my suitcases and getting ready to go back out for another trip.
Yeah.
So this has literally been God blessing for me to be home, spend time with the kids, spend time with my son, go out for bike rides, teaching him a little bit of maths and English, or he teach me, whichever you want to put it.
Yeah.
it's been honestly just absolutely amazing. Like, and the only thing that's hurt me more than anything is that my daughter doesn't live with me.
Oh.
And I've had to sort of, well, I haven't seen her for 3-4 weeks. I saw her for 2 days, a couple of days ago, and now I won't see her again for a couple of weeks because it's like we've got to keep these sort of space time periods in to see if any symptoms develop, and if they don't, then we can have her back. And it's a nightmare. So it's hurt me, and I can't see my daughter as much as I want, but I'm spending a lot of time with my wife, my son, and I know the circumstances are horrible, but I'm very, very thankful for this time at home right now. Very thankful.
Yeah, I feel the same way. I mean, like you said, last year was crazy busy. I mean, I was home like one weekend or two weekends from like February until October. You know,
it's
hard to even think back on that and understand. Well, you and I had talks on the road about how we were kind of, we needed just some downtime and we needed to reset a little bit. And so
I remember me and you, we were sat in a restaurant somewhere after like 4 weeks of filming with the History Channel.
Yeah.
And me and you were head in hands. We just couldn't cope. Like we had bags under our eyes. Oh, and it's like, right, we've got to go home for 2 days and then we're back out for another 3-4 week stint. It was horrendous.
Yeah.
Absolutely horrendous. So I feel your pain, man. Well, yeah. I mean, you went through that together.
Yeah. I mean, sometimes that's what you have to do. And that's, I mean, these are the talks that you and I had about, you know, just doing it. The opportunity is there and it, you know, trying to capitalize on the opportunity to make that happen. But, you know, for that to happen, you have to be gone. You have to be away from your family and kids. And that's very hard to deal with. So I'm the same way. I'm trying to be thankful for the time at home and, you know, spend more time, more quality time and that type of thing. And, you know, hopefully for you guys out there that are listening to this, you're able to do that same thing as well. I know it's a tough time and, you know, hopefully, you know, knock on wood, we can get back to normal here soon, and you know, basically the whole world's economy can get back working again. You know, because it's a crazy time, but trying to, you know, again on a daily basis, just be thankful for those small moments that we get to share. That's kind of how I feel about it. So, yeah,
nice way to put it.
Cool. Well, buddy, I think that wraps up the questions, and you know, I appreciate you taking the time. I think this is kind of fun, you know, even though I don't get to see you in person and we don't get to train or anything, it's kind of neat to be able to do this and you know, give the people a little bit of entertainment and fun. So, you know, hopefully again, once it's over, we can get together. You know, not that I really want to see you that bad, but you know, it's one of those things. You know, it'll be good. It'll be good when it happens.
Oh, for sure, man. Honestly, Brian, I do miss you, mate. We've spent a lot of time on the road together. And I was actually going to come over.
That was the plan.
Yeah. Today.
Sometime in late April, right? Is what we were talking
about. Yeah, I'm meant to be coming over to yours late April. Yeah. So the trip was booked. The flights were booked. The hotels were booked. And we had to cancel. So I think it was the 19th or 20th. I was going to fly out to LA, and then I was going to fly straight from LA to you.
Yeah.
We'll wait for this all blow over, and I'm sure we'll reconnect later in the year. Maybe even at World's Strongest Man.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
So looking forward to that. By the way, I think that'll be a good one this year for sure.
I think so too, man. I think I'm actually pretty happy. I haven't talked about that a lot, but it's rescheduled for the middle of November. Now, yeah. So hopefully all this is blown over by then, and you know, that can be a really good contest. And you know, the maybe exciting part for especially all the fans in the UK is it's going to go out pretty close to when the contest happens. I don't think that's ever happened. Yeah. You know,
no. I think the latest in the year we've ever had it, I think it happened in September one year.
Yeah,
and it was aired in December. So to have it in November and add in December is a real treat for the UK fans, for sure.
Yeah, because normally it's a lot of people try to avoid, you know, hearing the results and that type of thing. With social media now, that's basically impossible. So, you know, it'll be neat to almost have it happening, you know, in a time frame where it goes out on TV so quickly. So I'm excited about that too. I think it'll be kind of good, and hopefully by that point in time, the world's back to back to normal, or at least as close to normal as it can be. So,
yeah, no, sure it will.
Right on, buddy. Well, you stay safe over there, man, and I guess we'll catch up soon.
All right, Brian, you take care of yourself and look after your wife and kids, man.
Sounds good, buddy. Do the same, man.
All right. See you later.
All right, bye.